straight on him and worship him. So just forget about yourself and concentrate on him and worship him. So just forget about yourself and concentrate on him.
Welcome to Transformation Church. As you can see, our pastor is away this morning. She was asked to speak at a retreat, but she will be back soon. And Kathy wanted to make an announcement.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
I don't know if you guys realize it, but next Sunday is the end of the month of October. Does anybody know what next Sunday is?
Appreciation Day.
That's right. So, at the back of the church, there's two boxes, a pastor appreciation box for Pastor Shirley, a pastor appreciation box for Pastor Kathy. Gifts, whatever you, on your heart, you want to let them know how much we appreciate them. We're also going to have a meal together, a potluck meal together, which we all love potlucks, we all love to eat, right? So, on the back of the poster board back there, there's a piece of paper for you to sign up to bring a casserole, a dessert, something you like to make, something you love to make, to bless us all. There'll be about 30 to 50 people here, most likely, just so in terms of how much food to make, whatever you can afford and would like to bring. So we are going to have a meal. We're going to appreciate Pastor Shirley and Pastor Kathy, and so hopefully you guys can come out and stay with us a little bit. Happen probably about till 2 or 3 o'clock next Sunday. Okay?
Amen.
Thanks.
Amen.
Thank you, Kathy. And I just have one other announcement, but it's kind of a long one. Sorry about that. But you know that we're having, if you read your bulletin, I don't think we have them today, but other days, we are having a Christmas fair here on November 12th from 10 to 3. And we have some flyers over on the missions table on the right, well, on my right here. And if you know of a vendor or anyone who sells crafts, then if you could give them that flyer and maybe take one and put it if you, somewhere you eat out or whatever, a business would allow you to put that up, because we are still looking for some vendors. And we're also looking, we're having some church booths. We're going to have some face painting, so thank you for Felder and Abby for volunteering, and they could probably use extra help if anyone is talented in that area. See Velda. And we're looking for baked goods on the day, of course. And we also wanted the missions team, this is a missions fundraiser, so I should have mentioned that. And the missions team wanted to have our own like booth or whatever for artwork. So anyone that does any kind of craft or art, if they want to donate something, you can bring that in, let me know. And also we're having tag sale items. We're looking for basically Christmas items or something that could be used as a gift, especially if you got something, you have something new someone gave you, but you just don't have use for it. Just make sure it wasn't someone from the church. That may not go, that won't go over well. But anything in that idea, new or like new. and see me about that, because we don't really have a place to store it, and I know Pastor Shirley doesn't like to have stuff all over the place and people tripping on them. I don't know why, but she doesn't like that. So see me and we'll work it out. Okay, thank you.
Let's stand this morning and open up in prayer, please. I want to welcome our visitors this morning. If it's your first time here, welcome. The bathrooms are downstairs. The presence of God is up here. So you want to spend as much time as you can here, not down there. So, Father, we come before you this morning. We thank you for your goodness. We thank you, Lord, for your presence, God. We invite your presence into this place this morning, Father. I pray, Lord, for all those that have walked through these doors, Father, that you would meet every need that's represented, Father. Lord, that we would come in this morning expecting, Father, that we would come in this morning, Father, ready to praise, ready to worship you. Lord, help us, Lord, to forget the cares of this world, Lord, and concentrate on you this morning. Father, in the worship, in the word, Father, we just pray, Lord, that you would take control of this service. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
My heavenly home is bright and fair. I feel like traveling on. No pains, nor death. Traveling on, yes, I feel like traveling on. My heavenly home is bright and fair. I feel like traveling on. Its glittering towers, the sun outshines. I feel like traveling on. That heavenly mansion shall be mine. Traveling on, yes, I feel like traveling on, yes, I feel like traveling on. My heavenly home is bright and fair. I feel like traveling on. Let others seek a home below. I feel like traveling on. Flames devour and waves overflow. I feel like traveling on. Yes, I feel like traveling on. Yes, I feel like traveling on. My heavenly home is bright and fair. I feel like traveling on. The Lord has been so good. I feel like traveling on. Yes, I feel like traveling on. My heavenly home is bright and fair. I feel like traveling on. Verse 4, the Lord has been so good to me. I feel like traveling on. Until the blessed home I see, I feel like traveling on. Yes, I feel like traveling on. Yes, I feel like traveling on. My heavenly home is bright and fair. I feel like traveling on. Fly away, oh glory, life is o'er, I'll fly away to a home on God's celestial shore. I'll fly away. I'll fly away, oh glory. I'll fly away in the morning when I die. Hallelujah, by and by. Oh, I'll fly away when the shadows of this life have gone. Just a few more weary days and then I'll fly away. Oh, to a land where joy shall never end. I'll fly away. I'll fly away, oh glory. I'll fly away in the morning when I die. Hallelujah, by and by. Just a few more weary days and then I'll fly away to a land where joy shall never end. I'll fly away. I'll fly away, oh glory. I'll fly away in the morning when I die. Hallelujah, by and by, oh, I'll fly away. Oh, I'll fly away, oh, glory. I'll fly away in the morning when I die. Hallelujah, by and by, oh, I'll fly away. Oh, yes, I'll fly away. For that day, Lord God. Hallelujah. Soon and very soon. Oh, we're going to see the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Oh, praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah. It will be worth it all, church, when we see Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, thank you, God. Praise you, Jesus. Praise you, Lord. Praise you, Jesus. Walking around these walls, I thought by now they'd fall, but you have never failed me yet, waiting for change to come. waiting for change to come, knowing the battle's won, for you have never failed me yet. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never fail. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. Oh, this is my confidence. You never fail me yet. Oh, and you never will, Jesus. And I know the night won't last. Your word will come to pass. My heart will sing your praise again. Oh, Jesus, you're still enough, Lord. And Jesus, you're still enough. Keep me within your love. My heart will sing your praise again. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never fail. Lord, your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. Still stands. Great is your faithfulness, your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never fail, Jesus. Your promise stands. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never failed me yet. I've seen you move. Promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never fail. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You've never failed me yet. Oh, you never will, Jesus. Hallelujah. church, press in today. His word says, draw near to God and he will draw near to you. Oh, we draw near to you, Lord Jesus. The veil is torn. We can come, Lord, by the blood. Oh, into the Holy of Holies, Lord. Oh, what a privilege, what an honor it is, Lord. Oh, we can come into your presence and abide with you, Lord Jesus. Oh, we come, Lord Jesus. We come in humility, God. Oh, Lord Jesus. Oh, Father, by your blood we are made whole, Lord. By your blood we can come, Jesus. And oh, Father, we come to worship. We come to adore you. We come to lift your name on high today, Jesus. Oh, be lifted on high in this house, Jesus. Be lifted on high in this place, Lord God. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Jesus, lover of my soul. Jesus, I will never let you go. You've taken me from the miry clay, set my feet upon the rock, and now I know I love you. I need you. Though my world may fall, I'll never let you go. My Savior, my closest friend, I will worship you until the very end. Jesus, lover of my soul, Jesus, I will never let you go. You've taken me from the miry clay, you set my feet upon the rock, and now I know I love you. All I'll never let you go. My Savior, my closest friend, I will worship you until the very end. I love you, Lord, and I love you. I need you. Though my world may fall, I'll never let you go. Friend, I will worship you until the very end. Jesus, lover of my soul, Jesus, I will never let you go. You've taken me from the miry clay, set my feet upon the rock, and now I know I love you. I need you. Though my world may fall, I'll never let you go. My Savior, my closest friend, I will worship you until the very end. I love you, Jesus. I love you. I need you. And though my world may fall, I'll never let you go. My Savior, my closest friend, I will worship you until the very end. Friend, I will worship you till the very end. Jesus, lover of my soul. Jesus, I will never let you go. You've taken me from the miry clay. You set my feet upon the rock, and now I know I love you. I need you. Though my world may fall, I'll never let you go. My Savior, my closest friend, I will worship you until the very end. Oh, I love you. I need you. Though my world may fall, I'll never let you go. My Savior, my closest friend, I will worship you until the very end. I need you, Jesus. Oh, I need you, Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, Jesus, taking me from the miry clay, set my feet upon a rock, Lord. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord God. Oh, praise you, Jesus.
Welcome anymore. Forgive yourself today. Cast it unto the Lord. Cast it unto the Lord. Forgive yourself today. Remember it no more. Today is a new day. Today is a new day. Cast your care on the Lord. Remember it no more.
Are always open. If that God was speaking to you or anything you want to pray for, always feel free.
once again pour out my heart, for I know that you hear every cry. You listen, no matter what state my heart is in. You are faithful to answer with words that are true and a hope that is real. As I feel your touch, you bring a freedom to all that's within. In the safety of this place, longing to pour out my heart, say that I love you. Pour out my heart, say that I need you. Pour out my heart, say that I'm thankful. Pour out my heart, say that you're wonderful. Oh, pour your heart out to him this morning, church. Here I am once again. I pour out my heart, for I know that you hear every cry. You listening, no matter what state my heart is in. You are faithful to answer. Safety of this place, I'm longing to pour out my heart, say that I love you. Pour out my heart, say that I need you. Pour out my heart, say that I'm thankful. Pour out my heart, say that you're wonderful.
With our offering now. Steve, would you pray for the offering, please?
Amen.
Amen. And we are going to take two offerings today. So the first one is for your tithes and offerings for the church, and the second one is for our special speaker today, Glenn Meldrum. Come on up, ushers. Sorry. Father, we thank you for this special speaker that we've had that's not just for today, but he was here all last week. And we just thank you for this couple that give their lives so freely for you. And we just ask that you multiply this offering in to your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, worship team. I'd like to introduce our speaker now, Glenn Meldrum.
Praise the Lord. Thank you.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Father, I thank you this morning for my brother. I thank you for his faithfulness, God, to you. I thank you, Lord, that he's come our way, Lord, because he has a word for us today, Father. And I pray, Lord, that you would give him liberty, that you would give him the words, that you would have him to speak, Father. Lord, that you would touch our hearts this day, open our hearts and our minds, that we would hear your voice this day, God, that we would heed your call this day, Father. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Thanks. Well, the title of the message this morning is a distinction. A distinction. Turn with me to Malachi chapter 3. We live in some very challenging times. And I think they're going to get more challenging. Never in the history of the world have we been in the circumstances that we're in. Now, mankind hasn't changed in substance. Mankind is still mankind, whether it's from 1,000 years ago or 2,000 years ago or whether it's today. The difference is we've got technology, and technology has opened up a door into evil deeper than what the world has ever known. And it has had some good. I don't want to deny that there's been some good that's come out of it. I love being able to drive and travel in a motorhome and have a car and so on. And I like heat and running water in my house, you know. I mean, I appreciate some of those things a whole lot. But we're in some dangerous times. And if we don't understand that, then we're not going to live like it. Malachi chapter 3, verses 17 and 18. They will be mine, says the Lord Almighty, in the day when I make up my treasured possession. I will spare them just as in compassion a man spares his son who serves him. And you will again see the distinction between the righteous and the wicked, between those who serve God and those who do not. Very interesting verse here. Beautiful thought that's presented there. It says, when I make up my treasured possession. And so you know who that is? That is those who really walk with Jesus. And that is his treasured possession, and they will be his treasured possession forever and ever and ever in his presence. And so a beautiful, beautiful thought that's there. But he brings out this idea that he will make a distinction between the righteous and the wicked, between those who serve God and those who do not. When you go into the Exodus and you look at Israel's deliverance from Egypt, you see that 10 plagues were used to bring deliverance to them. And it's kind of interesting when you look at those plagues, God could have delivered them with one plague with one word. I mean, it was the aspect of God doing a whole lot in building up the children of Israel, but also lessons that we can have and things that we can understand. So there was the process that God was doing to bring that knowledge to us. And so the plagues came, the 10 plagues. The first two plagues that happened, the magicians in Egypt somehow copied them to a certain extent. Whatever that means, we're never really told, but they copied it to a certain extent. The third plague, they were not able to copy, and they went to Pharaoh, "This is the hand of a god." Now, they didn't acknowledge the Lord God, but they said it was the hand of a god. Then you come to the fourth plague. Now, the first three plagues came upon the people of Israel and upon the Egyptians, but now God was going to do something to help people understand something more than what had been presented to them through those first three plagues. And in Exodus chapter 8, verse 23, the Lord says, "I will make a distinction between my people and your people. This miraculous sign will occur tomorrow." So what this was is this was the plague of flies. And just imagine this distinction that upon the Egyptians was this plague of flies, but yet not in the area of Goshen where the Israelites were. They were kept from it. It's like this wall that was there that kept the flies out. And I don't know if you've ever been in a place where you've had a lot of flies before, but I've been in a couple of situations. One of them is growing up in the Detroit, Michigan area, going over the border into Windsor, because Detroit's on the border of Canada there, and Windsor's on the other side. And you can go over the bridge, and you can end up traveling a little ways and go to a place called Point Pelee. And if you go at the right time of the year, there'll just be thousands upon thousands upon thousands of monarch butterflies. I mean, it's just awesome. You go out there and you walk on this this area, and the monarch butterflies will land all over you and everything else. But guess what? If you want to see the monarch butterflies, you got to deal with 10 times as many flies. So the flies are just thick there as well. So you stand there, and the monarch butterflies are all over, and the flies are even more. And it's just terrible, you know. So just imagine what that would be to have no pretty monarch butterflies, just a bunch of flies, and then multiply that by even more, and it'd have to be one terrible irritation. Of course, it didn't produce any sickness per se in them, but just this major irritation. But God was showing a distinction, saying, "This is my people, and I'm going to show you they're my people, because this plague is not going to touch them, but it's going to come upon you." And then when you come to the next plague, it was upon the cattle, and guess what God did? He says, "I'm going to make a distinction here as well. Your cattle are going to suffer this plague, but the cattle of the children of Israel, the livestock of the children of Israel, will be exempt from it." So God was making a distinction, saying, "I'm going to protect and bless my people, and those who aren't my people are going to suffer the judgment because they have oppressed my people." And so God was going to bring a deliverance to the children of Israel. And so you have a situation that goes on, and we're going to look at this, and as we begin to move on and look at some examples of this in Scripture, we're going to see where this is taking place in the church. And I believe it's taking place right now between what is the true church and what is an idolatrous church or a false church. And God is going to make a distinction, and it's going to become more and more real all the time, because that's the heart of God. He wants his people to be seen and to be known, so that there is the people that he can say, "Look, these are mine. This is my treasured possession. These are the ones who belong to me." Those claim to be, but they're not. You see the difference? Look at the difference between their lives. Look at the difference of their relationships. Look at the difference even in the aspect of their marriages. See the difference between the two. And then look at all the more, the even more stark difference between my people and those of the world. There'll be a distinction, and he's going to make that distinction. He says, "I will do this once again." When you come to Matthew 24, Matthew 24 and 25 is Christ's discourse on his second coming. At the end of Matthew 24, there are three parables. Some may make it two, but it's probably three parables that are there. They're short little parables, and the purpose of those parables is to say, "Get ready, I'm coming back." All right, so that's what they were all about. You go into chapter 25 then, which is a continuation of that discourse, and you have three longer parables. And those parables are the same thing. Get ready, I'm coming back. But these three larger parables have some other thought that they're wanting to present in there, some different dynamics, and dynamics of what is going to make a distinction between the people of God and the people who are not of God. And so the first one you come to is the parable of the 10 virgins, and this goes from verse 1 to verse 13. There's a distinction made between wise and foolish virgins. But what we have to see in the beginning is all these virgins that represent the church, all these virgins were dressed in white, which meant that they were pure. They all had a lamp, and they all had a fire burning in that lamp. So it speaks of the life that they once had in relationship with Christ. So here was these virgins that all represented the true church, that were all in a place of fellowship. They were all the bridesmaids, in essence, of the bride. But it was a nice way of trying to say that they were all really the ones that were going to be the bride of Christ. And so he did that. He worded it like that so people wouldn't think that he was somehow justifying polygamy. So it was worded in such a way to try and help us comprehend something that he was presenting here. And so you have the situation of these virgins that at one time were all the same. They were all alike. They were all clothed in white. They all had a fire in them. They all had their lamp burning, but something happened. And we're not told how it happened, but something happened just over time. As the bridegroom delayed his coming, there were five virgins that stayed ready. They kept the fire burning. They kept the oil in their lamp. They kept themselves ready. They were watching. They were ready. But five of them became foolish. They let the oil burn out, the oil run out, and the fire burn out of them. And so when the bridegroom came, they were not ready. Something had happened in them that caused them not to be ready, and a distinction was made between the wise and the foolish. When the bridegroom was on his way, all of them saw the reality that the bridegroom was coming. And so what happened is the foolish says, oh, we don't have any oil. We're not ready for the bridegroom. We're not ready for his coming. So they begged the other virgin, says, give us some of your oil. Says, can't do that. That's not how it works. Says, you got to go get your own oil. So they left to go get their oil. But when they came back, the bridegroom had already come and gone. A distinction was made. A distinction that separated them. And that is serious, because then these same virgins went to the home of the bridegroom. And in verses 11 and 12 of that chapter, it says, later the others also came. Sir, sir, they said, open the doors for us. But he replied, I tell you the truth, I don't know you. So there was a distinction that God made with those that lived ready and those that didn't. What was the distinction? Because this is important. We've got to understand he made a distinction between the five wise and the five foolish. The distinction is that five had the fire of God burning in them, five had a passion for God, five had the zeal of God in them, and five had become lukewarm. So that lukewarmness was enough for God to say, there's a separating, there's a dividing here. Those that will be mine, those who will be my treasured possession, are going to be a people that want me, that desire me, that seek after me, that stay ready for me, that pursue me. And those who don't do that are not fit to be married. They're not fit to be my bride. And he'll make a distinction. The next parable, which goes in chapter 25 from verse 14 to verse 30, is a parable of the talents. It has a different purpose. They're all the same thing, saying, get ready, I'm coming back, but there's a different thing that's trying to be communicated here. And it begins in verse 15, where it says, to one he gave five talents of money, to another two talents, and to another one talent, each according to his ability. Then he went on his journey. So here you have this man, this wealthy man, that gives these talents to these various servants, and to those who had greater ability, he gave them more. Those who had less, he gave less. He did it compassionately according to their ability. So he wasn't expecting of those who had little ability to produce what those who had great ability. So he was being compassionate there. He was understanding his servants and giving them what they could handle. Then he went on his journey. In verse 19, it says, after a long time, the master of those servants returned and settled accounts with them. He came and he went and says, okay, I gave you 5 talents. And a talent is a lot of money, okay? So he gave him 5 talents and to one. And he says, I want you to give an account. What did you do with that? And the guy returns and he says, I gained 5 more. And he says, well done, good and faithful servant, and rewarded him accordingly. Then with the 1, the 2, he says, I have gained 2 more. He says, well done, faithful servant. And he rewarded him accordingly as well. Then he comes to the one that he gave only 1 talent to. And the man responded with some very twisted ideas. He says, I know you are a hard man, where you reap where you do not sow, which was an absolute lie. The talent the man got came from the master. The master gave him the money to sow it. But the man had a perverted idea of the master. Now understand, that is huge in this story, huge in this parable. He had a perverted idea of the master. And because he had a distorted idea about him, he responded to the master in an unacceptable way. The master even went and says, you could have taken that money and you could have put it in the bank and gained some interest. I would have been happy with that, but you didn't do anything with it. You didn't do anything with it. And you see, this parable is not about money. It's about the investment of what God has given us. And what is it that God has given you? Your own life. And so he's given you a life that you are to invest in this world for the glory of God, not for the glory of self, not for your own purposes. But if you have a distorted view about who this God is, then you're going to have a distorted life that comes out of it, and you are not going to serve him according to his will. You will serve him according to your own ideas, your own imagination, your own opinions, but not according to truth. And so what was the judgment upon the one? Verse 30, and throw that worthless servant outside into darkness where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. And I just want to share for a real brief moment here about the weeping and gnashing of teeth. That is not about pain. I do not believe God tortures people. I do not believe that. I don't believe that's what hell is. I believe hell is worse than we could ever imagine. But it's not God actively tormenting people. It is the result of people having the absolute absence of God forever and ever. The horror of that is more than we can imagine, because everything good and right and beautiful and just in this world comes from God. Imagine everything good taken away. The utter absence of that. And then imagine further the evil that's inside of us without restraint. The lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life. Nothing to restrain it like it's restrained now. To burn inside people in such agonizing ways. And what they got is what they deserve, because they didn't want a life with God. So they got an eternity without him. Serious, isn't it? A distinction is made over what people do with their life. A distinction is made. When we stand before God, that distinction will be seen, and it will be absolute. They will know. Those who walked with God will be forever his treasured possession, and those who did not will be forever separated from him. Then you come to the third parable, and it is so important that you understand the third parable from the first two. If you don't understand the third parable from the first two, you're going to get a distorted idea of it. That's why people take this third parable and turn it into the social gospel, that it's all about doing good deeds and giving food to people. And it's good to give food to people, but if people go to hell with a full stomach, it's no different than if they go to hell with an empty one. You understand, the gospel is not about just giving people food. It's about giving them the reality of the gospel. And people that are starving, that are on their way to hell, that want to know the truth, would rather have the truth than the food. But those who don't want the truth, they'll reject it no matter what condition they're in. And so this is the parable of the sheep and the goats, and it goes from verse 31 to the end of the chapter. A distinction is made here between God's people and that of the world, or those who do not have the compassion of God. Now, it's interesting, as we've been looking at these, the very first parable is all about the first and greatest commandment, to love God with all of your heart, mind, soul, and strength. This third parable is all about the second commandment, to love others as we want to be loved. And so here you have the first two commandments, and in between, sandwiched in between them, is the idea of what we do with our life in accordance with this. And so what you have is you have a king. And he says in verse 34, then the king will say to those on his right, come, you who are blessed by my Father, take your inheritance, the kingdom prepared for you since the creation of the world. And they said, where have I ministered to you, Jesus? Where have I clothed you and taken care of your needs? And Jesus said, whatever you did to the least of these, you did to me. So enter into the joy of your Lord. So there is the absolute necessity on how we treat one another. Those that were rejected. In verse 46, and they will go away to eternal punishment, but the righteous to eternal life. Those that were rejected, he says, when did we see you hungry and not feed you? When did we see you naked and not clothe you? And he says, whatever you didn't do to the least of these, you didn't do to me. So the necessity of how we respond to others, that second commandment. But you see, it's more than just putting clothes and food, giving them food. It's about what we do with the gospel and how we bring to them the reality of it. The difference between the two, the distinction was made of whether or not we live out the second commandment. But let me bring the reality to you. We cannot live out the second greatest commandment until we live out the first greatest commandment. The ability for us to love others properly comes from our ability to love Jesus supremely. I just got a text this week from a guy that I've communicated with over a little bit of time, occasionally on and off. He'll text me. He heard me preach somewhere. Can't remember who the guy is personally apart from the text, but, just out of the blue then, he just said, pray for me. I've just gone through a divorce. I'm not going to say this to be mean to anybody. This isn't the purpose of what I'm going to say, but we have to understand that divorce happens for only one reason. Sin. There's never a divorce that's done in righteousness. Never. It's always sin. It's corrupt characters that produce divorce. You understand, it's when two people can't get along. And the worst of all is those who claim to be Christian. And there's absolutely no excuse, because if they were living out this to their spouse, if they were living out the first parable rightly before God, there would be no divorce. You understand, divorce is because we walk in the flesh, because we do not crucify our sinful nature, because we allow bitterness, anger, all the junk rise up and we spew it out upon our spouse, and we destroy our spouse, and then we destroy our children because we will not walk in right fellowship with God. And then we try to say that, well, these are irreconcilable differences. No such thing for the Christian. No such thing. Because Jesus is able to transform the lives of any that want his transforming work. And if they will not allow him to transform their life, the fault is not God. The fault is not irreconcilable differences. The fault is that people do not want to be rightly reconciled to God and transformed. He will make a distinction between those who live out the true faith and those who do not. And this is serious, more serious than what we think. And that's why I am terrified for the condition of so much of the church, because people don't realize where they're really at. In Matthew chapter 8, verses 5 through 13, you have the story of a centurion that came and asked Jesus for help. And the centurion came to him and said, Lord, my servant lies at home, paralyzed in terrible suffering. And this servant was more like a son to this centurion, this Roman centurion. And so he was a man of position, and he would have been probably a man of wealth, because you see that sometimes the centurions would be people that would have a certain amount of wealth. And if I'm not mistaken, I think this one here actually even built a synagogue in Capernaum. Can you imagine how hard this would be for a Roman centurion that was the occupying force of Israel to humble themselves and to go before one of Israel's prophets and ask for help? I mean, I don't think you and I really understand the gravity of that, the seriousness of his humbling himself to be able to go to Jesus and ask for help. But he did, so he humbled himself. And actually, another account says that he sent a servant to ask because he said he wasn't worthy to come. And so when Jesus said in verse 7, says, I'll go and heal him, the centurion responded in an absolutely astounding way. Lord, I do not deserve to have you come under my roof, but just say the word and my servant will be healed. For I myself am a man under authority with soldiers under me. I tell this one, go, and he goes, and that one, come, and he comes. I say to my servant, do this, and he does it. Basically, what he was saying is, I recognize authority when somebody has authority. So when he would see a man that had, using whatever it would be today in the military, have stars on his shoulders, you recognize that he's a general. And you realize the general has authority, and he has way more authority than the little private. You understand? There's authority there. When this soldier looked at Jesus and heard what Jesus was doing, he says, that man has authority. He didn't understand who Jesus was, but he understood authority. What Jesus said happened. So that's all he said. That's all I need to. You have authority. You command. It will happen. That's enough for me. And he believed. That is good, powerful, real faith. And so when Jesus heard this, he was astonished and said to those following him, I tell you the truth, I have not found anyone in Israel with such great faith. That includes his apostles and disciples. I haven't heard anybody. Nobody has this kind of faith in Israel. You're to be the people of God and you don't have faith like that. Well, guess what? I don't think we have faith like that. That's the kind of faith that sees the miracles happen. That's the kind of faith that does see the dead raised to life. That's the kind of faith that accomplished something great for God. And then he made this point in verses 11 and 12. I say to you that many will come from the east and the west and will take their places at the feast with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven. But the subjects of the kingdom will be thrown outside into darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. What an interesting statement. He says, the children of the kingdom. What kingdom is he talking about? The kingdom of this world. The distinction is made between those who are of the kingdom of God because they walk by faith and those who are of the kingdom of this world because they do not walk by faith. A distinction is made over faith. You see, faith is so huge that we cannot be saved without faith. It's not this small little thing. By grace we are saved through faith. If we don't operate in faith, we can't even come to salvation, much less see anything else greater happen. Many people are left outside of salvation, even while they're in the church, because they think all they have to do is go to church or do some good deeds or whatever it is, and they're okay before God. But they fail to understand that entrance into the kingdom happens by faith. And faith, as the centurion demonstrated, comes about through humility, where we humble ourselves before this God and we recognize his authority, that he is the only authority, the only one that can truly save, that can deliver us and bring us all the way home so that we can be his treasured possession forever. But Jesus was also in this prophesying about the Gentiles coming into the kingdom of God and the outcasts. How interesting, because here you had these people that looked really, really religious. You see, they had their religious kind of clothes. The Pharisees had their particular kind of clothes, and it showed that everybody looked at them and realized, oh, those are Pharisees. And the majority of Israel would have revered them. And if you would have asked the average Israelite who's the most pious people in the nation, they'd say, oh, the Pharisees. Yeah, the Pharisees, of course. Because they looked it. They did their long prayers, and they gave their alms, and they did all the things to be seen of people, but they didn't understand what was really inside of them, which Jesus did. He said, you're like whitewashed sepulchers. Outside you're pretty, you're washed, but inside you're full of dead men's bones and every form of corruption. It wasn't enough to look good on the outside. It wasn't enough to go to church. It wasn't enough to be baptized in water. It wasn't enough to do all those external things. But there had to be the reality of faith. And faith is not just saying, I acknowledge the existence of God. Because in James we're told that the devil acknowledges the existence of God. But faith, true faith, is that place of trust where we throw our lives upon him, where we trust him with our life and we go beyond that. We trust him with our eternity. And as a result, the life is changed because of it. There's all kinds of people that can say that they have faith in God. But where's the evidence? Where's the evidence in the life? Where's the evidence in the lifestyle of holiness, the pursuit of God, the desire? Going right back to the 10 virgins, where's the evidence of faith where there's a passion for God and the seeking heart after him, the wanting him more than life itself? In verse 13, then Jesus said to the centurion, "Go. It will be done just as you believed it would." And his servant was healed at that very hour. The distinction between faith and unbelief. I will make a distinction. Then in Luke chapter 13, someone asked Jesus, "Lord, are only a few people going to be saved?" That's an interesting question, isn't it? Right? Interesting question. Now, Luke doesn't tell us if he was a disciple, so my thought is that he probably wasn't a disciple, because if he would have been a disciple, then I think he might have said, a disciple asked Jesus. But it was just a man that came up and asked Jesus, is only a few people going to be saved? Now, why did he ask that? I don't know, and I'm not going to be able to give an answer, because it's not we're not given that answer there. But it may have been that he wanted to know if he was being saved. He wanted to maybe understand, why is it that there aren't more disciples, more of the people that come and the crowds following you? Because Jesus could have multitudes. I mean, there's accounts that would be of 20,000 people, but yet how many disciples, how many people were truly disciples that were with Jesus? So here's what Jesus did, man. His response was absolutely phenomenal. Because, you know, he's the only one that could have went to him and says, "I know exactly the number of people that will be saved. I know who the very last person is that will be saved before I come back. I know what that number is, but I'm not going to tell you." He didn't need to know, just like we don't need to know, all right? Here's how he responded. "Make every effort or strive to enter through the narrow door, because many, I tell you, will try to enter and will not be able to." What a phenomenal statement. Okay, you want to make heaven your home? Here's how to do it. You strive. You make every effort. You put every bit of energy in your life into seeking God and seeking his kingdom and walking in fellowship with him, and you're going to be there. So he didn't tell them how many people would be saved. He told them how to be saved. He told them the heart behind what it is that those who are saved and those who will hear from him, well done. Because there'll be those who try to enter and will not. And they'll be the ones that hear, "Depart from me, I never knew you." Now, why would people try to enter and not be able to? Now, I know some people try to use this as a stepping stone to promote predestination, which I reject from a Calvinist point of view. I don't believe that's what it is. Because if you have the idea that some people are predestined to heaven, then you have the idea that some people are predestined to hell. And so that means God creates people for the sole purpose to destroy them forever in hell. And I don't see that the character of God in Scripture. I just don't see it anywhere. I don't believe that's what the Word of God teaches. 2 Peter, we're told where it's not God's will that any perish. And then you go to Ezekiel 18, and it brings out the same kind of thought that it's not his will that anyone would have to perish. So the heart of God is for all people to be saved. So the idea of somebody not being able to enter, though they're trying, it means they must be trying wrong. They're wanting to go to heaven, but they're wanting to go to heaven their way. They're wanting to go to heaven and saying, "Well, it's enough for me to go to church. That's okay. It's enough for me to put money in the offering, or it's enough for me to have some good deeds, and I hope my good deeds outweigh my bad deeds." But that's a very, very flawed way of thinking. Imagine you have a brother or sister that ends up killing somebody, and you go to the trial, and the man happens to stand up to defend himself and says, "Judge, I'm a good man. Look at all the good things I did. I think all the good deeds I've done should be enough to outweigh this one murder. It was just one murder. That's all. So all those good deeds should be enough to just let me go stark free." It's not how it works. You see, the man is judged for his crime. And all he did in the past is not going to take care of what that crime was. He committed murder, and for murder, he will have to be judged. And so if we are going to be a people that make heaven our home, then we must make sure that we are striving to enter through the narrow gate, because that door is narrow. It's a narrow door. And the only ones that will enter in are those who truly want to enter in and will do it God's way. Otherwise, all you become is a thief or robber trying to get salvation some other way than what God said. He meant what he said. You see, when he said, this is the way, walk in it, he meant what he said. Following him is not open for debate. It's not open for discussion of how it's to be done. He said, this is the way. What does he expect of mankind? To follow, to obey. What do we do as rebels? No, I want it my way. I don't think it's like that. I think it should be like this. And we have all of our opinions and all of our ways that we want to do it outside of what he has said. But he's still right. Now what Jesus does next, he brings out a parable. Verses 25 through 27. Once the owner of the house gets up and closes the door, you will stand outside knocking and pleading, "Sir, open the door for us." But he will answer, "I don't know you or where you come from." Then you will say, "We ate and drank with you and taught in your streets." But he will cry, "I don't know you or where you come from. Away from me, you evildoers." It wasn't enough to have close proximity to Jesus. They had to be in fellowship with him. They had to be in a place of true salvation. It's not enough to have sentimental notions about God. It will not make it that you can enter in through that narrow door. But didn't we see you do all these things? Didn't we call you Lord, Lord, like in what, in Matthew chapter 7? Lord, Lord. He says, "I don't know you. I don't know you." It wasn't enough for you to say, "Lord." You didn't bow to me as Lord. You didn't serve me as Lord. You didn't obey me as Lord. You lived your own life the way you wanted to, and you thought you could just add a little bit of Jesus to it, and it would be enough that you could make heaven your home. But that's not what you were created for. You were created to love him and serve him with every fiber of your being. And anything less is an insult to this God that created you with divine purpose to know him and love him supremely. Then in 28, he says, "And there will be weeping, there gnashing of teeth, when you see Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and all the prophets in the kingdom of God, but you yourselves thrown out." Here's this thought brought out again, right? I just brought that out in the prior parable. Same thought, same identical kind of thing here about those who are made a distinction between those who walk with God and those who don't, between those who are going to become God's treasured possession forever and those who are cast outside into a place of eternal torment and separation. Why? Because they refuse to do salvation God's way. They wanted to do it their own way. They wanted to negotiate. They wanted to say, "Well, I think this is good enough." All kinds of people that call themselves Christians do that all the time. "This is good enough. You know, if I go once a month, well, I guess I'm a pretty good Christian. And you know, I don't watch the X-rated movies like I used to." Well, you're just watching porn all the time. That's all. You understand what I'm talking about? I mean, this is serious stuff because something like 85% of men in the church, I'm not saying this church, but I'm saying in the church in general, are in porn. And nobody that's in porn can be a follower of Jesus. Nobody. It's impossible. Because it's the practice of sin. It's hostile to him. It's not a little problem. But how many people think that they're okay? And they fail to understand the truth. And then people will come from the west and the east and the north and the south and take their place at the feast in the kingdom of God. And you know, what is so disturbing in the verse I just read, where he spoke about the aspect of the weeping and gnashing of teeth, and Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and all the prophets will be there, but they cast out. You want to know part of what their anger is all about? Because gnashing of teeth is all about anger, like I said. They are angry that others are getting and receiving the goodness of God. Now, I do not doubt that we've had our little times in our life where there's been somebody we've been jealous of because we wanted something and we didn't get it, but they got it. But that's exactly what's going on here. They're saying, "Look, they're in heaven, but I was a child of Abraham. Why shouldn't I be there? Don't I have the right by family descent that I'm of the that I'm of the tribe of Levi or whatever tribe it was? Don't I have a right there? And he says, no, you didn't know me. You thought you had an in because you were of the right denomination, or you were of the, you were baptized, or all the other things that we try to say to justify ourselves and not being right with God, because we don't really want to give up our life to Jesus. So a distinction is here that's made between those who make heaven their home and those who don't. And the distinction is over those who strive to enter in and those who don't. You see, we have to understand something here that's really important, is nowhere is it put in Scripture anywhere that the door of heaven is open to those that approach Him with a half-hearted devotion. From cover to cover, it is all about wholehearted, complete, loving devotion. That's the only way He will receive us. But we want to rewrite that. We want to say, I can just add a little Jesus to my life, you know, come Sunday morning and everything's okay, but fail to understand that our life is not defined by Him, because He is not the love and passion of our life. And you know what's so astounding about this? When we make Him our supreme love, everything changes in our life, marriages, everything, because it's affected by that love for God that teaches us and helps us to love others correctly. The problem you and I have with loving people as what we should always comes from our not loving God like we should. And if we go to the root problem and begin to say, God, help me to love you more, that I might know how to love others, that I might have the grace to love others better, guess what? That's where the power is found. That's where it happens, because we begin to see the reality of our need and we start crying out for that ability to love Him more, that we might love others better. Then in Matthew chapter 16, verses 1 through 4, the Pharisees and Sadducees came to Jesus and tested Him by asking Him to show them a sign from heaven. He replied, when evening comes, you say, it will be fair weather, for the sky is red. And in the morning, today it will be stormy, for the sky is red and overcast. You know how to interpret the appearance of the sky, but you cannot interpret the signs of the times. A wicked and adulterous generation looks for a miraculous sign, but none will be given it except the sign of Jonah. Now, read these last words. Jesus then left them and went away. Do you understand that's what hell's all about right there, that Jesus left them? Why did they leave? Why did He leave them? Because they did not want Him. They didn't come asking for a sign, because there's already been so many signs, miracles after miracle after miracle, healings and blind seeing and feeding a multitude and all these miracles. There was so much evidence. Just think of the aspect of all the lepers that were healed, because prior to Jesus, this wasn't going on. And when lepers were healed, they had to go to the temple and they had to give evidence that they were healed. And then they have to offer up sacrifices. So now the temple has all these people coming in that's being healed. Testimony after testimony to the chief priests and the high priests. They all had evidence of the reality that Jesus had come, that miracles had happened like they've never saw, that He was the coming Messiah. They didn't come because they wanted to see a sign and believe. They were coming to test Him. He says, okay, the only sign you're going to have is a sign of Jonah. We'll look at that in just a moment. But because they didn't want to believe, because they were not willing to believe, because they didn't put themselves in a place to come in humility and embrace the Messiah, Jesus walked away and left them. But you know, this thing happened, the same thing happened earlier in the book of Matthew. That was from chapter 16. Chapter 12, verse 40 and 41. For as Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the belly of a huge fish, so the Son of Man will be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. The men of Nineveh will stand up at the judgment with this generation and condemn it, for they repented at the preaching of Jonah, and now one greater than Jonah is here. What an astounding statement. I'm making a distinction between those who believe in me as the crucified and resurrected Lord and those who don't. That's what that's all about. A distinction is made according to the sign of Jonah. So Jonah, that whole book of Jonah, was about a prophecy. Now, I believe it was a historical event, okay? But it was about a prophecy that was to point to Jesus. And then he says, those Ninevites that repented will stand in judgment against you who refuse to repent and continue in your sin, even though you look religious on the outside and you have all your rituals and all the stuff that you do. Says those Ninevites will stand against you and condemn you because you chose not to walk in true faith before me. And so a distinction is made over those who will repent and those who will not. Isn't that interesting? It gets right down to the nitty-gritty right here at the very point of who will repent and who will not repent. Because repentance is not going to Jesus and saying, I'm sorry. Because you know what happens when we say, I'm sorry? We keep doing what we've been doing. Repentance is turning. It's a change of heart. It's a change of mind that produces a change of direction. Now, I'm not going to say that as we are repenting that everything instantly changes. Because as Christians, we've got to begin to die and learn what that is to repent and die to these things. And there's this process of overcoming. But if we are truly doing it, there's this change going on. And we should be maturing from year after year after year as we grow more and more in Christ's likeness. The evidence of the mark of God upon our life of a Christ-like character should be more evident all the time. It should be seen. It should be understood. There should be the evidence in our life that we are true followers of Jesus, not just because we go to church, which we should, but because we are being like Jesus, because we're growing more like him, because we are overcoming our sin nature, because we're beginning to love him more and more. And by loving him more and more, we're beginning to love others better and better, because we're dying to our selfishness and all the other things that separate us from each other at one time. A distinction over the cross and what the cross demands of us. You see, the cross never went. Would you pretty please, kind of, sort of, maybe if you get a chance, say you're sorry to me? The cross demands our repentance because the cross reveals the only remedy for sin. And because sin is so utterly and absolutely evil, there is no remedy that can come from man. There is no good deed that can atone for the sins that we have committed. There's no righteous acts that we can supposedly do to blot those things out. We have been stained with sin so severely, so completely, so absolutely, nothing man can do to get that out. There's nothing we can do to get that out. But Jesus died upon the cross and poured out his blood that there would be a purifier, a cleanser, a means that we could be truly forgiven. And it comes from him and it comes through repentance because we fall before him and we cry out, have mercy on me, O God. A distinction. Because we really believe in what he did on that cross. We really believe that what he did was a timeless work that is for all of us today, just as it was 2,000 years ago, and just as what I believe it was for those righteous before then, because they could not enter heaven until Jesus died, rose again, and ascended into the right hand of the Father. A distinction is growing more and more obvious in the church between those who truly belong to him and those who don't. I can't tell you how often I have heard it, where people have come to me and says, I've never heard this preaching before. God, I'm not preaching anything special. I'm just preaching the gospel. That's it. Nothing special here. You know, I'm just willing to do it. But yet I've had people say, I haven't heard my pastor say the word sin in I don't know how many years. So what's he or she telling you? I mean, it can't be the gospel, of course, because the gospel is about the cross, and the cross is about our sinfulness, and that we are so wicked that the only remedy was for God to become human and die on the cross that we could be forgiven. What are they preaching then? What is it? People filling churches that don't preach the gospel that are lost. And if they're lost, it's because the preacher in the pulpit's lost. Because you're not going to have a saved man letting people go to hell by giving a worthless message. A saved man, a saved woman is going to give a saved message. You understand? It's going to be a message that points people to the foot of the cross. You got a good pastor that does that here. You got a good pastor that does that here. So remember on Pastor Appreciation Day. She did not pay me to say that. Okay? But you know what I've never found yet on the calendar? Evangelist Appreciation Day. I don't think they appreciate them, you know? Just. Oh, well, thank you so much. Oh. You see, the distinction that God is doing here is going to be eternal. There's no forgiveness after death. There's no such thing as post-mortem conversion. Okay, no such thing. This is the proving ground for eternity. This is the time that we are given to make our decision. And what we make is eternal because we are eternal beings. God created mankind different than animals. Sorry, I'm not trying to say anything against your cute little puppies and kitties and stuff, but I don't believe they have souls. We were created in the image of God, and we were made to be eternal beings. He honors that. You understand? Because we rebel against God doesn't mean we cease being eternal beings. It just means that as a result, we are separated from Him then. So where are you at with Jesus? Is a distinction made in your life that you are a true follower of Jesus? Is a distinction made in your life that if right now you stood before God, that He would say, enter in? Or would He say, depart from me, I don't know you? See, eternity is too long to gamble with this. It's too long. And I don't understand what heaven is. When I look at the scriptures, what speaks of heaven, it has given us in descriptions that might stir our imagination to understand that what heaven is infinitely beyond that. It's beyond anything we can imagine. But so is hell. Hell is given some words to describe something that we might think about it and try and comprehend what it is, but yet what hell is beyond that. Eternity is a long time, and we need to make sure. We need to make sure that we are in that right place with Him, that we don't gamble with our souls. It's too precious. Eternity is too long. A distinction will be made, and what side do you fall upon? And that's how serious this is. Father, we come before You now in the precious and wonderful name of Jesus. Lord, You know each of us by name. You know us, O God. You know us, O God. You know those who are truly right with You. You know those who are walking with You. You know those who are really striving to enter into the kingdom. And you know those who aren't. You know those who are half-hearted and they've tried to lie to themselves that it's okay, I'm Christian, I go to church once in a while, or maybe they go all the time, but they don't have any relationship with You. Lord, this is serious stuff, and all that matters is that we are right with You when You come back or You call us home. That's what matters, Lord, that we would be Your treasured possession. What a beautiful phrase that is in Malachi chapter 3, that we would be Your treasured possession, that we would be so precious to You. You, O God, who need nobody and nothing, but yet would look at us as a treasured possession. Lord, that's Your heart for all of mankind to be there. Lord, I'm asking for anybody that's here that is not right with You, that this morning they would get right with You no matter what it will cost them. In the precious and wonderful name of Jesus. If you are not a true follower of Jesus, if you're a backslider, a distinction is being made. It has already been made. It's just in this life we can change that. You understand? There's the ability to change it. We can be an enemy of God and then become His friend, because I'm a testimony of that. I was an enemy of God. I lived a life hostile. I lived a life strung out on drugs, and God broke into my world when I wasn't looking for Him and didn't want Him. He broke into my world because He wanted me to be His treasured possession. I'm overwhelmed when I look at my life, I look at my salvation and see what this God did when I had no right to it. I had no right. I could not have gone to God. Says, God, you must save me. I deserve to be saved because I couldn't. There was nothing in me that was good. But it was the goodness, kindness, and love of God that sought after me. And he's seeking after you right now. If you are not right with him, if you're some half-hearted Christian, if you're backslid or maybe never even really given your life to Christ, then this morning is a time for you to run to an altar and say, God, that must change now. It must change right now. Would everybody please stand? If you are not right with Jesus, if you're backslid and you want to come home to Jesus, you really want to come home, you want faith like that centurion that is just willing to say, I believe you said you would save. I believe that you will save me this morning. I believe that you will be able to change me because I am weary of me, O God. And if you want his salvation, then you're going to have something really big you got to do right now. You got to lay aside your pride. You got to lay aside pride. I mean, it is an ugly thing. It is a destructive thing. And many people will be left out of the kingdom because they're too proud. They're afraid of what people think. You understand pride, another name, a synonym for pride, is fear of man. That's what it is. It's being afraid of what people think. If you're not right with Jesus, you need to get right this morning. You need to get right. You need to make sure that you will give your life to him and you'll not leave this place without getting right. And so if you want to surrender your life to Christ, I want you to come forward right now. Is there anybody here that you're not a true follower of Jesus? You're a backslider and you want to come home. Please. Lay aside your fear, lay aside your pride, understand where your life really is at. It's time to run home to Jesus. I take this time because I remember my wife, she wasn't my wife then, 16-year-old girl, never heard the gospel before, raised in an atheistic home. The most of the gospel that she ever heard was Charlie Brown's Christmas story. That was it. And the first time she heard the gospel, the 16-year-old girl was sitting in the back, and you wouldn't know it now, but at one time she was so shy. And the preacher kept saying, one more time, is there anybody here? Anybody else want to come? And then he said, last time. And that was finally it. She came forward. And she never, ever looked back.
Hallelujah, hallelujah.
Last time, is there anybody here that you are not a follower of Jesus? Or you're a backslider and you want to come home? I want you to come right now. Now, church, I'm going to open this altar up for you. If you need to be at this altar because something is not right in your life, then you find a place up here and you talk to Jesus about it. That if he has confronted you about something in this message, then let him deal with you and don't leave the church until you have honestly dealt with him about it and cried out for the grace for him to change your life. And so if you need to be up here, I want you to come, church. This altar's for you. Thou art calling.
pass me by. Savior, Savior, hear my humble cry. While all others thou art calling, do not pass me by. Let me at thy throne of mercy find a sweet relief, kneeling there deep consecration. Help my unbelief. Savior, Savior, hear my humble cry. While all others thou art called, pass me by, trusting only in thy merit, would I seek thy face. Heal my wounded, broken spirit, save by thy grace. Savior, Savior, hear my humble cry. While all others thou art calling, do pass me by. Thou the spring of all my comfort, more than life to me, whom have I on earth beside thee? Heaven but thee. Savior, Savior, hear my humble cry. While all others thou art calling, do pass me by. Savior, Savior, hear my humble cry. While all others thou art calling, do pass me by. Savior, Savior, hear my humble cry. While all others thou art calling, do pass me by. Savior, Savior, hear my humble cry. was blind, I was running out of time. Sin separated, the breach was far too wide. But far from the chasm, you had me in your sight. So you made a way across the great divide. Left behind heaven's throne to build it here inside. And there at the cross, you paid a debt I owed. Broke my chains and freed my soul. For the first time I had hope. Thank you, Jesus, for the blood applied. Thank you, Jesus, you have brought me life. Thank you, Jesus, you have saved my life. Brought me from the darkness into glorious light. Thank you, Jesus, for the blood applied. You have brought me life. Thank you, Jesus. You have saved my life. Brought me from the darkness into glorious light. There is nothing stronger than the wonder-working power of the sons and daughters. We are ransomed by our Father through the blood, the blood. There is nothing stronger than the wonder-working power of the blood, the blood. That calls us sons and daughters. We are ransomed by our Father through the blood, the blood. So thank you, Jesus, for the blood applied. Thank you, Jesus, you have washed me white. Thank you, Jesus, you have saved my life. Me from the darkness into glorious light. Brought me from the darkness into glorious light.
Father, we thank you for this beautiful day you've given us. And I know you've spoken to, everyone today. Father, help us to take whatever you said to us today to heart and not just leave here and forget it, but to continue to look to you for the answers on exactly what you want for our lives and each and every day. We thank you, Father. We thank you for caring so much and always being with us, always helping us, always correcting us, always speaking to us. We thank you, Lord, in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Stronger than the wonder-working power of the blood. The blood that calls us sons and daughters. We are ransomed by our Father through the blood. Wash me white. Thank you, Jesus. brought me from the dark.